refer it again. You can refer it again. We'll do a little more structured way to see this purchase process. Okay. Okay. So in ERP data, whatever we have seen, let us first look at the taxation thing. So I just run this. I'll show the item tax control. Item tax template, GST 18% is what we already had, and 5% is what I created. So it is just that CGST was 2.5%, SGST is 2.5%, IGST 5%. That is how this is being done. Very similar to what we had done for GST 18% and kind of a thing. I should have deleted this to in-state GST 18% and out-of-state GST 18%, which was by default created. But earlier I did some transaction with that. Though I cancel the transaction don't get deleted. And since then, don't get deleted, I can't delete this now. So, but I would suggest, if you're very sure that we don't need these text templates, we should actually get rid of all of this because that removes the confusion. If there is any default that is set somewhere, you know, we could know that for sure. So just that to clean up things, we could clean up. But once you start making transactions, and now we can't really delete the transactions, it could be a challenge to delete this kind of a template. So we'll just have to ignore them for the time. So anyway, we'll need GST 5% for the time. I just went to the item list. Now, when I go to item list, I'm going to search for consumer 01 and consumer 02. So look at consumer 01. And here I need to go down to look at the item tax. And here we see GST 5% is what is mentioned. No tax category is mentioned, only GST 5% is mentioned. Same thing we could expect for consumer 02 also. So I click on consumer 02, reach down there. And in item tax, you see GST 5%. Okay. So this way, we are covered for the item tax part of it. Now we need to worry about purchase tax and tax charges template. So let me just go that. Purchase tax. So just like we did sales, thing I have did. Now there are already something in state GST, outside GST, which I deleted. So I just created some new ones. I didn't delete that part of it. I could have deleted that too, but I just retained it. But the existing one I deleted so that there should not be any confusion later. And I just mentioned inside state GST. I mentioned tax category inside state. And again, my tax categories are inside state and outside state. I just use that convention. And here it is 00. And again, for outside, it is IGST, which is only visit 0 again. We are not mentioned any default tax rate. So the advantage that we do by not mentioning any rate here, that it becomes mandatory for us that we have to have item tax template defined. Okay. What happens is, I mean, there are two ways to look at it. One is that you define some default rate, like 18%, which is commonly found. Just got Monica in. So one is we use some default rate, which is like 18% here, and that gets picked up by the system. And whenever you mention item tax, you know, the that tax kind of comes from that item tax. So one approach to do it is that let us define default here is 18% here or 9%, whatever that is, whether it's this CGST, IGST. And then that becomes default. And whenever you want to make some differences, you use item tax template. So item tax template override whatever is mentioned in the purchase taxes and charges. By making it 0, we exclusively rely on item tax template, which essentially means that for each item, you have to mention item tax template. Obviously, there are few items where there will be zero GST. So 0% is also a valid value in a way. But most of the items will have some tax, right? And that you need to mention. So by mentioning zero, we are actually putting a constraint on us that all items must have item tax template, almost all of them. So which is a good idea, because in GST particularly, this item tax, and there are good variation there. There's a many slabs like 0%, 5%, 12%, 80%. There is one more, I guess. So then, you know, it is imperative that we go and explicitly set the item tax. Once it is very clear that we're going to use item tax, okay. That's the reason we're doing it zero. Otherwise, if you mention some value here, it will be picked up as a default value. Okay, so we're done with the taxation part of it. We'll see whether it is working or not. I mean, fingers crossed. I mean, that if Vaishali's case didn't work, we hope it will work. Let us see how it goes. Before that, let me just show you the price list that I created. So let me type price list, and it's a price list. Yes. And we had already defined this gold, silver, platinum, and the standard selling, standard buying are there by default. Consumable is the one which I defined, which is nothing but it says buying one, and India is a country, and it is enabled. That's all, nothing more than that. So that one thing that we have done. Now we'll define the item prices also. So I just go to item price, item price list, and for consumable 01, I have mentioned it's for buying, that price is what I was mentioned. This is important because it kind of puts some constraint in a way. So if you try to use this pricing list for selling, it will not really work, or it should not work rather. 250 rupees is the rate which I given, and valid from 16 because I made the entry yesterday. So it is valid from that time, but we could change this date. So you could always define this price list depending on when you want to make it valid kind of thing. Same thing for consumer 02, where we had done 60 rupees. So if you remember earlier, the item prices were 250 rupees. Now it is 250 and 60. I think we changed, we increased the prices essentially. So that we should make a note of it. Okay. Now we will start the purchase process. But let me take a pause here and see if there are any questions. Yeah, so Saili has raised hand. Yes,
sir. Sir, I have one question. Sir, instead of adding item tax in the item master, can we add tax into the purchase taxes and charges template? Means tax rate.
Yes, yes, you can do that. But the challenge is that if you put 18% there, so that's the one way to do it. You put 18% there.
We can add multiple purchase taxes and charges template, like GST 18%, GST 5%. So that will be not an issue.
Yes, that is also possible. You are correct. It is just that the way we see it, the world, we see that tax is applicable for the item.
Okay.
That's the reason we associate it with the item. But what you are saying is correct. You could actually define purchase tax template for inside state 18%, inside state, that way. So you can define as many tax templates and it will give the same effect. What we're doing. It may not look illogical to someone who's looking at it, will believe that, you know, this is not the correct way, because, you know, it is dependent on item to item.
Because the previous means what you said is not working for me, means adding item tax for the particular item, it was not working for me. So what I did is I added purchase taxes and charges template directly, means I added rate into that, and I have selected that one, and I got the correct values. So
that's fair for the training purpose, but when we do the production run, so generally what happens is that we put this practice for the organization. So if you just do this in the implementation, when these people start using it, they will be required to follow the same convention, which somebody will question, why are we doing this? Because you know, it's item tax and not really the purchasing time we are making decision. Another way to look at it is that right now we are using one user, which is doing everything. Right?
Yes.
Going forward, different people are working on different things. Those people who are in stores will actually mentioning the item taxes. And those who are in purchase department will just go ahead and make a purchase. So they will not be aware. Somebody. They should be. Actually, in small companies, they would be. In small companies, again, there will be only one person doing all of it. But you can be never sure about it. So somebody who is just doing a purchase may not be aware of different items. Another small problem that may happen is that in one purchase order, you may have two items, one with 5%, the other one is
12%. Okay.
That would be a difficult, so they have to make two purchase orders.
Yes.
Now, in training, we are making purchase orders as per our convenience. But in real life, they would have a big purchase order with 20, 30, 100 items also. In one purchase order, with different taxes. Just like you go to a DMart or some similar supermarket kind of a thing. They give you a big list of 30, 40, 50 items. And each will have a different taxation. The reason I have to use the word grocery, because in grocery there are many words, zero taxes, 5%, 12% and all that. So you would see that that will not be possible to done with the purchase tax.
Okay, thank you.
So I know it's a little painful to explore and see what is the problem, and it really takes a lot of time to figure it out. But yes, that's what the part of the and it's very common. I mean, even in production, we do first implementation, we do conference. It's a conference room pilot kind of thing. So we sit in the conference room and just enter all the master data and run some transactions to check how things are working or not. And it's invariably we go back, use that red button, delete everything, start from scratch, and again see some problem happening, delete everything, we don't know why it is happening, and so on. So those frustrations are there as part of any project. So even same with the training program also. Though we are taking a simpler cases, but if something gets stuck somewhere, it becomes really difficult to
position. Okay, sir. Thank you.
So now let us move to actual purchase process, and you can open that ERP data.xls, and I can see that image that I had put in there, which basically shows some kind of workflow, and it starts with material request. And as I mentioned last time, material request is something that anybody can put in. It is called material request more from the manufacturing perspective, but it could be anything. It could be acquisition request, you know, or something like that. There are different names would come. Okay, that is another thing that you need to, when you go to implementation, this is a typical requirement that we don't call the material request, we call something else. So that something else is something that we have to figure out. What is that in that country? So it could be anything. It could be sometimes people use different documents. One for office staff, they will purchase some stationery using some document name. And the other guys will use, in shop floor, they may use something else. But in the system, we have material request only. So nothing new per se that we need to do. It is actually a material request to raise the request. So we'll do the material request. Then we'll create a request for quotation, which we'll send out to suppliers. Obviously, we'll not be sending an email per se, but we'll just show you how we can do that. Then we create a supplier quotation per se. As I mentioned last time, suppliers can log in. We can give logins to suppliers, and suppliers can log in and create quotation on our site or system, which is a great way to you know, get the automation done, because you don't need them to send paper-based thing and somebody enters the data, and you know, they may make mistakes and all that. And you can pick up any supplier quotation, not any supplier for quotation, but the lowest or most feasible or most profitable kind of a quotation to you, profitable to you, not to the vendor. And then you can purchase order. And then we'll make a payment entry for advance. Then you get a purchase receipt, goods received note or GRA, and what we call it. And then you get a purchase invoice and then make a payment. That is a flow that we will do. So let us start with material request. So let me go ahead and check that. Okay, admin officer is joining. Okay. So let us go ahead and look at the material request. just click to the list of material requests. By the way, because of search bar, I'm not really going through the model. So we're actually switching models. Right now we're in the stock model, by the way. Then we'll move to purchase, buying, and then we'll go to accounting and all that. So you can keep a stock and a track of it, that this is what is happening. Now we'll create a material request. Now we'll just go ahead. We're saying purpose is purchase. Now it will be purchase, it will be material transfer, material issue, manufacturer, customer provided. Sometimes it is provided by the customer. So that is also one option. So there are multiple options available. Right now we'll go with the purchase option. And then we'll pick up consumable 01. So let me just go ahead. Consumable 01. We'll say required by today itself. And how many we need? Consumables 170. So we'll just take 70 here. Before that, we have to worry about the price list. Let us see where the pricing details are. We'll anyway check that up. Consumer 01 target warehouses comes up raw material, because that is what we have defined as a default warehouse, but we could change it if required. Unit of measurement, we have measured the numbers in our item master, so they are just kind of picked up out here. We also see a download button here, which will create an item CSV file. I just open that, and it actually has kind of a template, Excel template, to upload the items that you want to upload. Okay, so basically what happens in real life, you will not have only one or two items, you will actually have many items if you're doing something. So it will really helpful to just put in Excel and upload it. So that's why this download upload is there. Material request, there's no pricing details out here, because just material request. It will be printing details if they want to have a letterhead or something like that, terms and conditions. And we just say save. Okay, so it got saved. By the way, you also have this things called get items from. So many times you'll not do it just like that. When you're in a sales order, you are putting some order request. So for example, if you are in a trading business, so I buy laptops and I sell laptops. So if I get a request for buying, selling laptops, then I'll go and buy it first. That's where I'll get the items from sales on. So you could do that. You could get it from bill of materials also. That is more for the manufacturing person. So anyway, we have, in our case, we just enter this data. And there is no pricing out here, because I think it's just a request right now. So this is from the store or from the office. We could have created the request. So I just go ahead and submit it. So permanently submit it, yes. Okay. And now I get a hero link bell. It says it's saved, and this is what I got. Now, as we know, we could always go and it shows a pending. If I just go and material request, it says pending is a status. So it's kind of has some status tracking in a way that it says it's pending. Now I can create a purchase order from here, or I can create a request for quotation, or I can create a supply quotation. Either way, so these three options are there. We'll go with the longest route, which is a request for quotation. So let me just create a request for quotation. So this is what I'm sending out to the suppliers. Okay, so here I need to mention who are the suppliers that I'm going to send to. So I could say which supplier I want to send. Supplier 05. So let me just say supplier 05. And what are the contacts, and whether you want to send an email or not. So emails are sent from the system, so that I'll uncheck for the timing, because we don't have email addresses. But yeah, you could actually do that. Okay. Items have come from here. Okay. You could actually send an email, so you could do salutation, some beer, something and all that. So writing email, the name will come from the, obviously, contact list. Then email template, there are templates available. You could create a multiple email templates. So standard templates you could have, so that you could use. You could put some subject, and you can preview email. So it will show you that. So email address is required for it. So we don't have that, but I guess you get a point that you could actually set up all these things. There's a lot of setup involved. But once you set up this, this like becomes very easy for people to just send across. This model, if you see, is buying model. So this is being used by the purchaser. So I know this kind of written quotation part. And then with terms and conditions, again, they're not doing anything here, but you actually have a lot of stuff over here. You know, it should be, you know, we're doing inspection on it, and you know, we will, there is a lot of terms that they may put in. So any purchase order typically would have all those things, or request for quotation will have all those things. You need to really ask the client what are the things that they typically put in and put in also. And then there are printing headings and all that. So anyway, so we'll just put a request for quotation. This is save. And you can add more to it, obviously, not necessarily that only these things. The buyer could add something more in the same request for quotation. And I'll just submit it. And I just create a purchase request for quotation. I just hear a bell now. Let's say this is done. And this thing is now done. Now, obviously, you can create a supply quotation from it. So, assuming that we have sent it across by hard copy, they have filled in and sent us a supply quotation. So, now I need to create. So, I could obviously need to select. So, depending on what you have given in that suppliers list, you could see the supplier quotation here. So, let me just do it for supplier 05. Okay, and here we can select the price list. Now, what would happen actually, there could be either possibilities. One possibility is that you have your price list and you go ahead with it, or you get whatever is given by the supplier. So here we're taking a case that we are using our own buying rate, whatever they are. But in real life, it could be anything. So this is one possibility that we use our own thing, or it could be something that supplier has mentioned. So now once the moment we put it that price list consumable, we see that 250 has picked up and we get 17,500, something like that. Now comes the most difficult and challenging part is taxes and charges. So let me just go ahead and this is inside sales. So I'll just take inside state GST. And fortunately, it has picked up correctly. When somebody just confirmed that this is the right number, 875. Okay, the quantity, I think, yes, quantity is 17,500.
Yes, sir.
And we got 875. It's the right number. Yeah. So we got this. We are not getting any discount per se. If they are there, we could mention it here. But let us, for the time being, we'll go ahead with this. And we got this kind of a quotation. I just say save. And I get a submit. So it's draft right now, and I see a submit. Okay, so we got a quotation now. And now we could actually go ahead and from quotation, we could actually create a purchase order. Okay. Let me take a pause here and see if there are any questions now. Specialization GST rate is not showing. Let me just go and check. Yeah, rate is not shown. That is correct. But we could look at the tax breakup. Sorry. So here you could see it. So here it may not make sense also to see it simply because we have only one item, but there could be multiple items, kind of a thing. So we should check for the tax breakup. And that SHN number is basically the code for that product, which is again part of the GST legislation. So each item has got some HSN code, which we need to either enter in the system. Then taxable amount, and this is what we do. So you may not see, I have never seen any rate coming here. It always shows the zero. So I always use this tax breakup to check. So this is seems to be correct. So this is where we have to verify. Does it answer your question?
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir.
Yeah, Ashish.
Sir Dhananjay.
Sorry, Dhananjay.
Hello.
Yes,
sir,
yes, you can speak.
already. Hello. Yeah.
Yeah.
I have completed my purchase cycle yesterday. Like both transactions I have done it. In instant transaction, there is no error occurred. But when I was creating a consumable 2 for supplier number 6, that is outstate purchase, I got that error, GST error. Both three taxes are coming there. So I need to delete it manually, that adjust your CGST amount. That one thing, one error I got.
Okay, so next time you get this error, instead of manually deleting, you just delete these ones, purchase, just change it again. I mean, reselect it basically. So many times it flows to the next document. So whatever it is there, in-state GST or out-state GST, you just delete it and again select it. That should
for
help.
GST transaction, I got only one error that.
No, you say error message or you got that problem?
No,
that all three were
no
there.
Message. Yeah, that three taxes by default coming there.
Huh. But then you did you try changing the purchase tax
yeah,
template
yeah,
that
yeah.
time?
I have tried many times, but same thing happened.
Okay, let us see whether we get that kind of error, whether that is happening or not. We need to really check out what has gone wrong somewhere. Okay, so I think there's one question from Ashish. Yeah. What if we select ignore pricing rule? So pricing rules are basically a kind of a rules which are we can define. So let me just show you that. I think the list will example will be there in a way, but you could actually define some pricing rules, and these rules are defined. And you could actually say apply on item code or item group or something, and we can say discount and how much that could be and so on. Now what would happen is that these are different accounting kind of a thing. So what people could do, I mean, again, this ERP will be used by multiple people, right? So people in buying would get some supplier quotation, and the supplier quotation would be for say this item, it will be something like 2,500 rupees, and they just accept whatever supplier question kind of comes, which doesn't happen, they kind of check. But in system, you could have some rules which would be there, which will basically say that what kind of a discount which must get from the supplier, from that particular supplier of your, from that category of suppliers or something like that. So you could have some pricing rules. If I'm buying from this supplier, I must get this kind of a discount on the list price or something like that. Now, if you define those pricing rules, then you are not allowed to make those purchases which will violate the pricing rule. Okay. So there are two ways they could be used. One is that the most preferred way is use a guideline. So sometimes the purchase guy may forget, it's got discount, they may not remember all. So they will just go ahead and put it, and they will get, this is by will get applied. The pricing will be applied. So it kind of makes the life easier. For them, but sometimes they may actually want to override saying that okay, current situation, maybe whatever this COVID situation, might market is not favorable, whatever it is, the pricing rules are not applying. Then you can ignore those pricing rules. Now again, here we are just doing saving and submitting ourselves only. But again, real life people have different people. I mean, there will be somebody will purchase, executive will create the purchase order, and the purchase manager will submit it, which essentially means that he will review all draft purchase order and submit. That time, he or she is responsible to verify whether pricing rule is properly applied, is it overridden or not, and so on. So as the company grows, this what is the checks and balances to be applied to ensure that no one single person takes the company for a ride. So all these checks and balances are there in the system, and even when there is no system, ERP system, people will have some rules kind of a thing. But here, it may get enforced also. So those things are important for large companies where they would be keen that you know all these rules are kind of mentioned there. So a purchase executive should not make mistakes, intentional or unintentional, either. Does that answer your question, Ashish? So since I'm this topic, let me tell you that there is something called segregation of duties, SOD. I think some of you might be heard of this term. This is what the auditor will check. So whenever companies, auditors audit a company, they will check for segregation of duties. So what does it really mean? Is that suppose you have a purchasing the purchase department, you make a purchase order. So segregation of duties would mean that the person who creates with the right authority to create purchase order should not have authority to approve it, and the person who has authority to approve it should not have an authority to create it. Okay, now this looks very odd, but that is how you ensure that frauds do not happen. That if I have an authority to create and approve, then I'll just buy something and nothing will come to the company, I just make some payments to the vendors. So a fraud could happen that I just create purchase orders and approve them. But when you have two people doing it, and one may be junior, one may be senior, that could be possible. But there are still two people. So the probability of you know fraud still comes down because somebody is creating, so he or she is concerned. Because my name is there, you know, that audit trail will be there. That this person has created and this other person has approved. So either person will be fearful or will be honest and the fraud may not happen. Obviously, both the people agree, then you don't know. But and these things do happen. So systems are also where to there is also auditor who would actually go through the audit trail and check, you know, how frequently things are happening and all that. So when you are doing an ERP system, that's an advantage that company gets, that all this is recorded. So it's not piece of paper which has lost, but all this data is there. Somebody can look at it, open up and check, you know, who is, how the purchases are happening. Are we favoring only one vendor? Are we getting three quotations or not? Like, for example, this case is only one quotation, which is not a good idea. So whether we're getting three quotations or not, it's easier to audit if somebody sitting in headquarters than earlier when all these papers used to be there in different departments and different locations. Here are one location where you can audit. So ERP system is liked by auditors because you know you just need to log in and check what is going on. So okay, so now we have, so far we have done material request, customer quotation and supplier quotation, time to create a purchase order. But before that, let us look at our financial statements and see what condition they are in, because I will see some differences going there. So we have a balance sheet. Okay, yeah, so there is a provisional profit and loss here. So now we see this application of fund. So current asset, we have got some bank account. In Bank of Maharashtra, we got some money, 7,74,000. You can make a note of these numbers also. And the stock in hand is 3,29,000. So that is what we have assets, current assets essentially. And then we have a capital account, which is 10,00,000 shareholder fund. We got duties and taxes. This is again, this is what we have to pay to the government. And when we purchase, these numbers will also get affected. So please make a note of it, that these are the numbers that we have. And then obviously there's a provisional profit and loss so that we can tally the numbers. So that is how we're getting it. By the number looks bigger simply because yes, we have sold laptop and desktop and earned some profit, but we also sold a service of software support. And there are no expenses that we have got for it. So that's why you get a big number of 81,000. So you should be able to read that balance sheet accordingly. That it looks very high, the profit, simply because for the material, the laptop, desktop, we had some buying and selling. The difference is the profit. But for service, we just sold the service without incurring any expenses. That's the reason we don't have, that's the reason we have such a high profit. So anyway, let us go to the the other thing, which is profit and loss statement. Yes. So in profit and loss statement, okay, so we see income, sales is 124,500. Expenses, here we see cost of goods sold, which is, as we actually discussed on the group also, that is a items for which we have a valuation rate, and the items which are sold, not all the items, but the items which are sold. So cost of goods sold, so what are the goods that were sold? The cost of those goods is what is mentioned here. So that is what we see, and the difference is the profit for the year. This is yearly. Anyway, this will be same as monthly also. But yeah, this is yearly. Let us look at the stock. Let me type the stock. Cash flow I'm not looking at. It's anyway going to be simple. Okay. Now in stock, let us see whether it is stock balance. The stock balance over here. Okay, so here we need to select this item group item. Let us just select. We don't have really great data. So okay, so consumer 01, consumer 02, we see balance quantity of 30 and 15 respectively, and the balance value is 6,750, and somewhere we should see the valuation rate. Yeah, 250. So now we have got new stock, which is 250 and 60. So we should be careful with that. We look at the stock ledger. So this is the stock model, by the way, stock balance. Then look at stock ledger. The moment you hear the word ledger, you know, it has something to do with accounting. So it's a stock model itself, but here you would have all these accounting like vouchers and all that, and we have seen already that this transaction has cost in, that we sold one desktop and a laptop, and otherwise everything most has come up with the stock reconciliation. Okay. And there's a delivery note which has happened where the stock kind of went up. Okay. So this is what the current status is. Now we'll go ahead and create a purchase order. Okay. So to create a purchase order, we're creating it from this from the quotation. Let me go ahead and find a supplier quotation. In real life, I would get many supplier quotations, and I will choose one of it. So let's just create supplier quotation, which is only one which we receive, and I do create. Now, please note, the reason I'm going from supplier quotation for two reasons. One is I get those items already there, so I don't need to type it again. That is one thing. But more importantly, I get a link from those documents. Okay. So I could do a create, which is what we do, or we could also see click on this purchase thing here, the plus sign here. Okay. So this tab is very important. It shows connections, and this is the power of ERP, actually speaking, this whole tab. So it shows that you could actually create a new purchase order or a new quotation. Quotation is for the customer. So we could get a quotation from a supplier. Based on that, we can create a quotation for the vendor. So you could do that also. That's a trading business typically. So you get a quotation from the supplier, maybe add some margins and create a quotation for the customer. So that is where this plus sign is here. Whatever you see a plus sign here, you'll also see those things in the create. Okay. So this is one way. There's a reference. So this supplier quotation is linked to one material request and one request for quotation. This could be 2, 3, 5, whatever that could be. So you could have references out there, and there will be some subscription that we did not discuss more, but related, where you can create new documents, related documents, or you could have a reference which are going kind of a back. So you can go onward and you can go backwards, kind of track it down. Okay. So instead of creating, I will just click on the plus sign, which will be the same effect. So I create a purchase order. Okay, and I have many things. This is 70 or 250, and taxation is not correctly. So that thing has not flowed, the purchase taxes and charges template. So let me go ahead and put it inside state GST. And it has calculated correctly. I'll just go to the tax breakup and see it's 2.5%, 2.5%. So that part is done. And we have got the purchase order. So this is created by the purchase department or the purchase department executive. And then this should be submitted by the authorized person. So it's just to confirm. So when it is saved, you can delete it. But once you submit it, you can't delete it. So that is the biggest thing, difference between these two. This is also called a make and check. And so somebody made it, or some other person has to check it, that okay, everything is kind of correct, no mistake anywhere. So we need to kind of verify it and then go ahead and submit. Okay, now let me take a pause here and ask you, do you expect any impact on any of the financial statements with this kind of a thing, purchase order? Okay, Special says no, because we just created a purchase order, just like that, nothing very significant per se, but that is something that is required for the vendor. So when you actually get a purchase order, we create a commitment basically for us. That first we need to kind of we have said somebody that please go ahead. So anybody gets a purchase order, we'll start executing. So in a way, it's a commitment that is given to the vendor, because I'll buy from you, sort of. Just to check, we'll go ahead and look at the balance sheet. This is unlikely to have any impact on the profit and loss statement, but we'll go ahead and check the balance sheet. And yes, there's no change. We just have everything out there. And even the taxes and everything looks very, very in place. So we'll not go ahead. Now we'll do something unusual, which is we'll give some advance to this guy. So let us go ahead and do that. So let us go ahead and do the purchase order. Here the status shows to receive and bill. So we have not received anything. So whether we see whether we can get an opportunity to create a purchase payment from here. I'm just clicking on create button. It's okay. So you start getting this plus things also related. So you could actually get a, you can actually make a payment. So we'll make a payment now. How much is the amount? What was, okay, yeah, there is a type of payment. Payment type is pay, so they're paying it. Supplier, party type is supplier. Some bank account will be there. So all this is master data. So once you have master data, things would be pretty easier. So this is the details which are actually came in. So money will go from the bank to that creditor. And paid amount is 18,375. Let us make a partial payment rather than making the whole payment. So let us pay 10,000 rupees. So instead of 18,375, we'll pay 10,000. Okay, I hope, yes, paid amount is 10,000. We're allocating 10,000 right now. And let me save this. The system has become very slow for me. Okay, reference number or reference date is mandatory. So this could be a check number. So let me just put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Again, here we are doing bank payment transaction, but there will be multiple ways transition to be done. So all that will has to go in the master data. We will just save this. Okay, this is done. Same is done. So we are making a payment of 10,000. Submit. Yes. Okay. So we have a reference out here. This is a reference for that payment date. Now let us go and check what is the impact on the balance sheet. This has become pretty slow for me. This is kind of fun. Let me wait. Okay, so will the system, by the time system comes up, let me check if there are any questions. Started moving in. Okay. Do we see any change here? Okay, let me reload. So we could see that earlier the bank account has 7,74,160. That has become 7,64,000. And stock assets has also changed, or they are same. Stock in hand, what was the earlier number? Stock in hand. Anybody noted that?
No change.
In stock in hand, there was no change?
No change.
Okay.
So we not
received any books. Yeah. So then here, so here is just a balancing act here. So here we say there's an accounts payable, which is minus 10,000. So generally, when we create some invoice or something, we get some accounts payable. We need to be paying it. In this case, it is minus 10,000. Essentially means that we already paid it to this. So this is how we got interest in profit and loss statement. So we got change in bank account, which is obvious. Money has gone there. And in liabilities, we got accounts payable, which is minus. So which is, in a way, this is money that we already paid, prepaid kind of thing. So that is how we got it, minus 10,000. Okay, it's not a liability, it's a negative liability. We don't need to pay. We already paid 10,000. Okay? So this is the impact that we see when we make any payment. Okay. Here, I guess if you see cash flow statement also, we didn't see cash flow statement earlier, but we could have seen that change here also. So mine is really different, but yeah, so we'll not see so much of breakdown here, but if you see breakdown, there is some net change in accounts payable, which is minus 10,000 that we see here. The remaining things will remain the same, but this new entry has come with net change in accounts payable. Or it is zero, or it is minus 10,000. Profit and loss should not have any changes. The sales, there is no sales done. Expenses are anyway same. So there's no change over here, which is what we would expect. Okay, so by now, because of a payment, we got some things out here. Now let us look at next thing, that is purchase listed. So we give a purchase order, and now we'll receive the goods. Okay. Now, when we receive the goods, which statement should see the difference, change? Let me ask this question. Where do we see the, okay, stock will change because now we got full stock. So you can check full stock balance or you can check stock ledger. Stock ledger is perhaps better way. And generally, people prefer look at stock ledger because they also get the transaction that happens. So that is something that will definitely change. So we need to check that part of it. Okay. It also impact the balance sheet. Yes, no. When we receive goods, will it impact the balance sheet? What do you guys think? Vaishali saying yes, it will impact balance sheet. In what way, Vaishali?
When we receive goods, inventory get increased. That's why in stock amount will get increased.
So which head it will see the impact?
Let me check.
Okay, they're saying it's stock in hand accounting.
Yeah, yes. Stock in hand.
Because we are doing a perpetual inventory. So whatever inventory we are kind of increasing, we see there, we'll see the increase in the in the balance sheet also. So when we do perpetual inventory, which is by default now, any change in inventory, anybody's buying, selling, transferring, you know, immediately your balance sheet numbers will change. And when you see that increase in stock in hand account, you know, we'll see also some increase, some changes in other, because you have to tally ultimately. It's the balance, it's a balance sheet, it should balance. So we'll see that how things really happen. Obviously, we don't expect anything in the profit and loss statement, but we should expect something in the stock ledger and in balance sheet. So let us go ahead and receive those things. Now to receive, we'll obviously go first with the purchase order. So let me just go to purchase order. Whenever somebody receives it, when it gets a thing, it will first check the purchase order. So there's a to receive and bill. So we just open that. So this is what a purchase guy. This actually, by the way, sometimes it could be received by somebody else other than purchase. Sometimes it's received by the branch where the material is required. So accordingly, those permissions have to be given. So here we are creating a purchase receipt. So from the purchase order, so somebody has to first look at what are the things that were ordered, and then we just create a purchase receipt. So it's a good received note, GRN or purchase receipt. Okay, so I just created a purchase receipt. It is become very slow for me. So yeah, yes, it is kind of refresh now. So here it is, series, some numbers have come in. You could edit posting date and time when we receive it. Now this date and time becomes in a way important because your valuation, I mean your balance sheet skips on change. So if you creating a balance sheet of 31st March, and if you receive this material on 31st March, and you know, it's very important that it should get recorded to get in that particular year's balance sheet. Otherwise, you know, it will not be really complete. So many times you receive goods and make entry later. So in which case you have to edit this part of it. So, okay, so we, so there could be a supplier delivery note number would be there, which we may need to enter. And except the warehouse and all that is mentioned. So we just take it as it is, purchase receipt. Okay, now again we have to see the challenge here with the taxation. So I'll go ahead and put it again inside. So by default it's not coming properly. So I just apply it again. So Dhananjay, we're getting the same kind of thing that what you got. The IGST is not going away. Okay, it's working. Yeah, so just waiting for this thing to load. We didn't load the way we wanted it to load. Let me again go ahead. The taxation thing is not working so well for us. So Dhananjay, is similar like what you're getting, right? Is not there. Okay, it worked. So I guess this should not have happened. It will may need to kind of file a bug or something like that. We need to really kind of change this purchase taxes and charges template. Refresh it, I think, because it's more of a refresh issue. But yes, it kind of got what we wanted. Let us verify the tax breakup, things will happen. Okay, so I would avoid deleting it, and this is absolutely necessary from here. Try to see whether you can check this, change this, and it should work. But anyway, we need to keep on watching this. So let us get this purchase receipt in. So we basically indicate that we have got the goods and now we'll submit it. Permanently submit. Yes. Okay. And now what is remaining is we need to now this could be printed or email if you want. Now let us go ahead and check what is the impact on the balance sheet first. This we need to refresh. Okay, do we see any difference?
I think stock in hand is increasing.
Yes. So now it is increased appropriately. What is the amount that got increased? So what was the earlier amount?
3,29,000.
Okay, so something like 17.
750.
Yeah, so 13 or 750. So excluding taxes, so that is what happened here. Okay, then let us go down. Account payable is still minus 10,000 because that invoice is not generated. So, okay, CGST, SGST, do you see the difference? No, not because invoice is not there. Now there's something which has come, which is a stock received but not billed. So all these 17,500 worth stock has come in but is not billed, so that stock liabilities are there. There is something which is not billed. So we got it. We are supposed to pay for it. It is not even billed. Forget about payment. We are not even got billed. So this is a new entry that comes in here, 17,500. And we also saw the stock in hand as a new entry. Let us go to stock ledger now. And here we see an entry. 100, counted is 100 now, 70. This is the raw material, consumable. And last entry is what we got. Now incoming, now this, we have to see what are the headers. Let's see the headers. Incoming rate is 250. balance value is 23, sorry, and the valuation rate is now 235. So earlier we had 200, okay. Incoming rate is now 250. So somewhere it was 200, and we got some, how much we got at 30 that time. And now we got 100 at 250 rates. The valuation rate has now changed to 235. Please make a note of this, the change in the valuation rate that has happened. This will matter because that will impact cost of goods sold. So when this will be sold, obviously this is consumer, it will not be sold per se. But when it will be sold, we will be using this valuation rate. That is where it is important. It's just like an average of it, essentially. This is a purchase receipt that we receive. So we got this out of it. Okay, so now we have to do a purchase invoice, which is an important document. So we'll go to the purchase receipt. This has become slow. Purchase receipt. Because it will make sense to data against it. So this is set to bill. So now we'll get, so we have basically got an invoice from the customer. So we'll create invoice now for it. So it's a purchase invoice, receipt plus sign here. Okay. Again, this is refreshing because I'm not able to get that cursor for clicking. Okay. Page unresponsive. Is anyone of you also working simultaneously on the system and getting the similar error? So is it a problem with the server or is it a problem with my machine? I don't know. So I'm checking with you. Is anybody also working on their system and getting the same error or same response? Yes, Saili.
No, sir, I'm not getting any error.
Okay. For me, it is kind of frozen. Okay, now it is done. Okay. So now I could create purchase invoice. So I clicked on it. Okay, so queue date, everything will just take whatever it is. Supplier invoice details, so they must have sent some invoice number, so we need to make a note of that. What are the invoice number? This is our reference, in a sense, whatever their reference, you know. So we need to get that because we are creating purchase invoice based on their invoice. So they send the invoice to us, a bill. Now we need to create in our system, so we create as a purchase invoice. Okay. So anyway, this is 170,500. Okay. Now here we have not got the tax breakup at all. Okay, now again things are a little messed up here, so we need to really correct them. So this is correct, right? 250 into 70, that is 70,500. Then the taxation things have again gone up. I'm just typing inside. GST. Okay, this has come correctly now. Oh my goodness. Okay, so let me see if there are any questions in between till we get that question. I guess I missed one question from Vaishali in between. Where to mention payment terms? So Vaishali, that is typically when you open a request for quotation, only you mention the payment terms. So if you have a very specific thing, like for example, some companies have a policy that they don't pay out advance or whatever reason, just don't give. So you could mention that the payment terms. So there are both ways the payment terms could happen. I mean, as a supplier, as a buyer, you may say, this is my payment terms. I don't pay advance. I pay only after 60 days, something like that. And the seller, the supplier in your case, may also have a payment term saying that I want 50% advance and I want remaining payment within 30 days, something like that. Now, that is where the negotiation should happen outside the system. And then you kind of adjust. So you may start with your own payment terms. But depending on who is more powerful in a way, or who has more market power, so to say powerful doesn't mean muscle power, but market power in terms of supply demand thing, the payment terms get negotiated. So payment terms becomes a very important aspect of negotiation. What is the price, obviously, that we want this at 250 rupees, he will say 500 rupees and you kind of negotiate. But payment terms become even more tricky to work with, but you can negotiate and sometimes that works a bit. Okay, so here we are. So payment terms are here. So we could have our own payment terms, so to say. And we're just trying to see whether how do we handle the get advances paid. And here we get. So I just click on this get advances paid, and there's a reference number, and it says remarks amount INR 10,000 to supplier 04 transaction reference is kind of given. Advance amount is 10,000, allocated amount is 10,000, is what is kind of coming here.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
We have paid the 10,000, but our invoice amount is 18,000.
Yeah, because the invoice amount is 18,000, we already paid this much. So that we kind of make a note of it. So invoice amount will not come down. But what we need to pay later will come.
Okay.
Because this invoice amount matters for our transaction. So this is the final invoice amount. But the payment will come down in a way.
Mm-hmm.
That we will see. So let us go ahead and save this. And then let us check the taxation again. The taxation has become very, very fragile in a way. We need to keep on checking. Yes, this is correct. So let me submit it. And now we see what is the impact. So we don't expect much impact on the, so we'll expect major impact on the balance sheet. So let us go ahead and check for happening the balance sheet. Stock we anyway got, so that is not an issue. We are not made any sales, so there's nothing like selling that will happen. But balance sheet, we should see some impact. So let me open the balance sheet. Let me just refresh it to begin with. Okay, let us see what happens here. So bank, we have got 764, stock in hand is 347047. That's correct. What was the earlier entry here? Somewhere there was something here. Page unresponsive. So it looks like my machine error. So maybe next time we'll do someone else's machine. Okay, there's a question here from Snehal. Who can create request for quotation after multiple request is generated? The request for request for quotation is generated by purchase department. So multiple request could come from anyone. Many companies will have anyone actually create multiple request because one person is working on it would know what material to be needed. So anybody can create multiple request. It goes to so basically what happens is in paper based situation. You have a kind of forms where you create a material request that I want this acquisition request or something, material acquisition request, and it goes to purchase department, and then they start working on it. And that is where they first look at material request and then create a request for quotation. Depending on the value, the thing, if it is 100 rupees, 200 rupees, they may simply put a purchase order, or sometimes even do purchase invoice for that matter, just quickly. But the typical process is to create a request for quotation or request for quotation. Does that answer your question, Snehal?
Yes, sir. But I want to ask one more question. That is it mandatory to create a quotation, or we can generate directly purchase order after creating a material request?
Yes, you can. You can. As a matter of fact, I think the purchase invoice would be purchase receipt is required, because if there's a stock that is coming in, the receipt is anyway required, and purchase invoice is required. Okay. Sometimes even purchase order could be skipped, though it's not a good idea to do that. So the flow that we have shown is the ideal flow, and what we call the textbook flow, which is what one should follow. But in real life, people may not be using it. But purchase invoice is required because it really has an impact on balance sheet. Purchase receipt is required if you are tracking the stock ledger. Without that, you will not get it. Purchase order could be skipped, but that also indicates there is a serious issue in a sense.
You've no, sir, not purchase order. Can we skip quotation?
Yeah, you can. But it is not advisable.
Okay.
And if it's a small company, you definitely can.
Okay.
But it's a large company, not only you can't skip, you also need to have minimum 3 quotations.
Okay, sir.
So in real life, many times it happens that a vendor goes to a purchaser, say that this is convinces them that this is what they should buy, and the supplier will say, okay, give me 3 quotations. So he'll call up his friends, or he may have 3 companies, so to say, and he will generate 3 different quotations. Okay. And literally submit it as kind of a compliance part of it. Yeah? So it's more of a compliance thing.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so hopefully this has come here. So we got purchase invoice. We don't see any change here, actually. Did we see a change?
Yeah, in creditors, earlier it was minus 10,000.
Now it is
8,375.
Yes.
And one more account was there, which was saying that unbilled transaction, that is 0.
Yeah, so that has gone out. Anything in CGST, SGST?
No, I don't see anything. 5,367. Yeah, it is changed.
It has changed, right?
Yes.
Okay, because we get some credit now.
Yes.
So just to verify what is the change, go to CGST, click on here, go to general ledger for CGST, and
437 debited.
Yes, 437 is what we got debited. Yes, it should debit entry. But yes, that is what we got as an input thing. So now, so since we used only one tax for account for CGST, it get all will get affected here. So if you have 2 different things, then you will see 2 different accounts. So there's no change in this account, but there will be an entry for the other account. So both ways you could do it. Either you can create two different accounts, for one for input, one for output, and you will maintain this two different thing, or you need to go and check whether you got any balance debit entry for it or not. So this has happened. Anything else in balance sheet? I guess our this thing stock in hand has anyway come in. Happened with purchases only. So this is what we have seen. Stock ledger is anyway done. So purchase invoice will have an impact on balance sheet. So that's become a very important part of it, because it's kind of, there's a liabilities and all that, we'll kind of take care of. Let us go for a payment entry now. So we'll go ahead with purchase invoice. Actually, I could see that purchase invoice in the search bar itself. The search bar function is pretty good. Otherwise, we need to search and find in the module wise thing. But this comes pretty handy. This shows as unpaid. This purchase invoice is unpaid. So now we need to go ahead and pay it. Again, there could be a multiple days of difference that could be there. So that's it. Now you already see there's a one payment entry done. So that one is here. Okay. And you can also create another entry. That is what we see here. Or you can go to create. And you can also see the references. One purchase order is referred to this, and one purchase receipt is referred to. If you want to make a returns, then you need to create another purchase invoice. We're not covering those details. But in real life, we could have very, very complicated things anyway. So the larger the company, the complications will be more, because you want a lot many checks and balances in test. So you don't want to miss anything. So let us wait.
Before moving ahead, can we check supplier ledger?
Yes, let us check the supplier ledger. We'll do that. Hold on, my pages are unresponsive. Yeah, it's a good idea to look at those reports. Let me exit now and just, I can't do that also. I can't even exit, it just says. No, I could actually. Okay. Oops. Okay, let us go to suppliers. Actually, we did that. We missed it actually in a way that we would have. Oh, yeah, I think, but we are not paid yet. So this is. Check whether
we are not able to see your screen.
Is it okay? Yes, can you see the screen now?
Yes,
yes, sir.
Yeah, so in buying thing, by the way, the purchase order we are saying zero to receive because we already got it. Zero pending. So we could have actually gone and checked it. So anyway, I mean, we will not do that so much often, but somebody who is in buying department will keep on opening this thing and we'll see this kind of a dashboard sort of thing. 27 items are available, zero pending, because we got one. We kind of received it and purchase order zero to receive. So all those things will keep on changing. So you could check it up when you are doing the work. We could also look at supplier. Which one you want to look at? Supplier. Why sales? Vaishya, do you have any specific
supplier ledger
report in mind?
Supplier ledger.
Supplier ledger, okay. That should come in the. That will be an accounting. Yes. Opening balance, invoiced amount, paid amount, debit note, closing balance. So we have 8,000 rupees pending. So this is what we would expect. We already made a 10,000 pending, advance pending, and this is still pending, 8,374. So again, in account
can we see aging of that particular vendor? When to pay the? What is the due date for this particular invoice?
Is there aging report or something? Here, there is something account receivable, accounts payable. We could look at accounts payable. Actually, we're kind of paying it. So there is a 8375 to be paid between 0 to 30. So this is 100% of our payments are kind of due between 0 to 30. This is, I guess, closer to what you're looking at. Actually,
yes.
So we can go to
0 to 30 is the bucket
in
size.
Our case is the bucket right now because ours is not that, but you have something above 120 and above. This is something which is yes, you're not able to pay. So that is what it would mean, and obviously the details will be out here. So now we need to make
One more query. Yeah, what if in case of 100% payment, you have payment terms 150% advance, then 30% after 15 days, like that, how this report will reflect that? Actually, I wanted
to. Basically, what has happened is that the invoice is generated for this amount. So typically there are two ways it could happen. Sometimes some companies will raise the invoice for the whole amount and get some advance against it or make the part payment per se. So we have only one invoice. So once invoice is there, you kind of get counter starts for the days. So this is like the invoice is generated today and we have 8375 to pay. Now if we pay some of the 5,000 rupees now and after 30 days we pay remaining amount, so that will move here, so it will come here in 30 to 60 days. So this is based on the invoice part of it. But large projects which we execute, we typically raise invoice for the installment only. So in a project which runs for a year or two or something like that, people raise invoice for the part amount, not for the entire amount. So it depends on the policy of the purchaser and seller. How do you really? That's what a negotiation happens. How do you want to really raise the invoice? So some companies will say raise the invoice for that particular installment type because the amount could be different. Or you could raise one single invoice and then make the part payment as a way things happen. But if you make a single invoice, then you will see those numbers out there. So this is from a buyer's perspective. For seller also it's a problem. They raise a sales invoice, and then they're kind of waiting for the payment to happen. So they had to show aging very badly. Whereas, it is actually decided earlier, 30%, 50%. So typically aging would be seen more from perspective of you agreed to pay, but didn't pay on time. So so you need to structure the invoices accordingly. So if you agreed to pay for a particular amount, you raise invoice only for that amount. Don't raise invoice for the entire amount. And then you may have some part payments if needed. Does it answer your question, Vaishali?
We have to manually update the percentage or what you say. We have to manually raise the invoices as per the payment terms. System automatically will not create invoices. In case of sales, suppose I have defined some percentages for raising invoices, whether it will get automatically created or we have to create manual invoices with the bifurcation of agreed percentage payment terms.
So that's a choice. Like for example, I recently did one business with the university. We agreed for two installments, 50% in the beginning, after doing some work, and 50% after doing the remaining work. But the purchase department said, raise one invoice. And we'll pay you 50% once some work is done, and remaining 50% after work. So their system shows one invoice. And it shows as if there's a part payment is done. Okay. But in many cases, when the projects are longer, this was like 2-3 months project, so it makes sense. Why to create multiple invoices? But if the project is running for 1 year, then you don't want to create single invoice. You want to create multiple invoices, because if you create single invoice, then it will show as aging, that, you know, payment is pending kind of a thing. So you will create multiple invoices, but that you need to create manually, obviously, because system will not know what you decided. So whatever you decided should be entered in the system. Now, if you're talking about subscription, if, for example, you are doing this software as a service, and on a monthly basis, you will pay a fixed money, like you will pay something like 20,000 rupees per month. Then there's subscription mode, which you can use, where this automatically invoice gets created every month on a given date, and the payment will be done against that invoice. So that's a subscription thing that we can use in ERP.
Okay, thanks. And one more question, what about a valuation? As you said, there is a valuation calculated, 235 valuation rate, 235. It is based on average.
Yes.
I think there is one more type, standard valuation.
So we'll discuss that as a valuation methods are there. And there are a couple of them supported. Valuation itself could be very complicated.
Okay.
But we'll at least look at what valuation is there in the ERP.
Okay. Where should we maintain that valuation method in Item Master?
Yes, I'll show you that to you.
Okay.
I mean, I'll show you the class.
Okay.
About how the valuation would change.
Okay.
But this is the default one, which one we are using, which is generally used in many cases. But some specific industry would need something specific valuation. I'll discuss all of that tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Any other question before we go ahead and create a payment entry? Anybody else? I know it's 11:06, but yeah, can you just look at the purchase invoice and create a payment entry? So this shows as unpaid, because we still need to pay that 8,000 rupees. So really, now I think the challenge to see whether we really get that payment entry correctly, the amount. So posting date, everything is okay. Accounts, yes, the paid amount is 8,000. So it's showing us correct thing. So there is a purchasing invoice which has come in. And this is showing 18,000. Outstanding is 8,000. Because you already paid 10,000. Now sometimes you actually pay less also, if in case there's some damages things or some inspection you did and you found that something was not correct, so you pay less. All those things are there. Why people actually pay late is because they are not really sure the quality. So once they receive, they do some inspection, they figure out there's some problem, and they negotiate again, and then you settle down or something. So that is a very common thing that happens. But okay, we'll take a normal situation and we just go ahead with 8,000. So we'll make the payment. It'll ask for the reference number. Yes. So let me just put a reference number. And we'll put today's check date. So we're just saving and submitting. Now let us go to the balance sheet and see what happened. So our bank balance has come down again. It now becomes 7,500. The stock asset is anyway with us, and in tax we already seen. Anything else that has changed?
Creditors got zero.
Yes, so that creditor things has got disappeared because that amount has got adjusted. So this is how we have completed. There is obviously not any change experience profit and loss. It's just a payment which is made. This is a purchase. There's no sales. If there's a sales, then obviously it will have impact on the profit and loss statement kind of thing. It will remain as it is. Okay. Stock ledger also will have same because we already looked at purchase receipt. So purchase receipt will actually impact the stock ledger. The payment is essentially impact the balance sheet. So each of these transactions will have some impact on the balance sheet part of it. Okay, so that's how we have finished. I thought it will take 1 hour, but it took more than one and a half hour actually. But I guess this is a complete cycle. We had some glitches with the taxation but I guess it could work without deleting manually deleting anything. We just had to reinforce or refresh that template, and it took care of it. So whenever you face an issue with taxation, just don't manually delete anything. Just ensure that you change this thing. The template, text template, purchase text template, and that should take care of it ideally instead of doing something manual. Okay, so any last minute questions from any one of you?
Shrikant, I have created a different account for GST input, and in my case, it is not working. So I'm not able to move ahead with the same configuration.
One thing you can do, you can go ahead and reverse those interest and delete those additional tax accounts and do the way which I have shown.
Okay. For training purpose, I will use that GST instead of using separate account. I will use same account. It is working for me.
Yeah, actually what happens is that there's nothing right or wrong here. It's just that you, if you have different accounts, you can see now what we've seen is that in the same account, we saw two entries.
Yes.
We saw this entry coming in and you need to kind of manually go and check that. Some people prefer input. Personally, I wish to earlier show create input, separate input accounts. But nowadays I started feeling that this is much better idea because creating too many chart of accounts, interest accounts is not a good idea. So, but yeah, it's a personal preference or company preference. It should work. I don't know why it is not working, but you could try it out. I mean, I think you can do smart in that sense.
Yeah,
you could delete things, check it again.
Yeah,
and if it doesn't work, go ahead with a single account for a GST.
I'm trying for last 2 days, but it's not working for me.
No. Okay, then I think you just go ahead and use the same single account for the taxation.
Okay.
So every one of you, please do this in your system. And if you have any issues, please report that on the group. Maybe I will help, you know, and there are quite a few people who have done it by now. Should be able to help and resolve the issues. In next session, I think what we didn't do today is what we'll do next session. Is that we will resolve the issues if there are any. If not, if everybody is correct, I'll also post a quiz. If everybody is getting 5 out of 5 there, then we don't need to worry about it. We'll just go ahead with asset creation. Otherwise, we'll resolve the issues. So we'll use a live session for that. So just see how fast we can get it done. And any issues, please keep on reporting so that we can, if something is resolvable, by looking at the description, let us resolve it in the group. Otherwise, we'll share your screen next session and we'll look at it. Okay, any questions before we close the meeting? Okay, then let us close for today and we'll see you day after. Have a good day.